So, hello. Let me now please come to the second part of the first lecture. Usually my style is directly writing on the blackboard. I will change that now here to this electronic version. Hope that this works well for all of us. Second part of the lecture is on optics and chapter 2.1, electromagnetic waves. So, what do we know about light? As you have heard in the first part, light has a spectrum. And let me please summarize again. Radio waves here, the range for AM radio is a wavelength of, let's say, about 100 meters. FM, the mostly used frequency in our days, the wavelength range is in the order of magnitude of 1 meter, depending on the frequency, that of course changes. For radar, we typically have a wavelength of about centimeter size. Infrared radiation. Here we talk about a wavelength range from 20 to 1 micrometer, and 1 micrometer is 10 to the power of minus 6 meters. Finally, visible. As mentioned before, that's a pretty narrow range, 380 nanometers to about 780 nanometer. Beyond that, UV, that starts again around 380 nanometer and goes up to about 10 nanometer. Why am I not that precise here? And for example, why is there a gap between infrared and radar? Point is that these specifications which I'm writing down are sometimes a bit loose. The visible range of light is pretty well defined. You literally see it by eye. However, the starting point of UV and the high energy point of UV depends very much on the problem. Please note as well that wavelength scales inversely with energy. So the lower the wavelength, the higher the energy of the incident radiation. And a simple example from everyday life: if you go to the beach, the sunburn is caused by the UV light. So lower the wavelength, the higher the energy of the incident radiation. So beyond UV, the so-called range of X-ray radiation starts, and in research we call that range below 10 nanometers already soft X-ray. The X-ray tube typically used in a hospital or in our research lab has a wavelength range around 1 angstrom. And that's 10 to the power of minus 10 meters. Beyond that, we have gamma ray. And here the rough definition, it goes from 0.0001 nanometer, which is about 0.1 picometer and even lower. And once again, the lower the frequency, the higher the energy in the end. So that's a rough classification of the wavelength spectrum of light. Another number which we had heard before is speed of light. Light has a certain speed. And the precise number in our days is 299,792.458 kilometers per second. That was already determined by Fizeau in 1849 with his quite simple but extremely interesting experiment. So he had a candle, a strong candle, carbide candle with a reflecting mirror, and at the distance of 8 kilometers, a reflecting mirror. And in between, a spinning wheel with open slots. The light passed through the slot, returned, and after that time, when the light returned, the spinning wheel had already turned by a certain fraction, and actually at a certain velocity of that spinning wheel, the light got completely blocked. And from the velocity of that spinning wheel, he was able to calculate the speed of light simply through the time delay which it took to pass these 2 times 8 kilometers path. The result was pretty remarkable, 314,000 kilometers per second roughly, and that's pretty close to what we know in our days with the precise number for the speed of light. So that was a remarkable result. And 1861, Maxwell finally published his publication, Maxwell Laws, but also in the end, the wave equation for electromagnetic radiation. And by comparing his number with the determined speed of light by Fizeau, he concluded that electromagnetic radiation is actually light and traveling with the speed of light. So I personally find that quite remarkable, given the fact that at that time the technology was by far not that advanced as we know in our days. So, electromagnetic waves. So here we should start from the Maxwell equations. And actually, let me summarize them again. So we have the Gauss law for electricity. Integral E dA, flux lines of the electric field to a certain area, is equal to the enclosed charge divided by epsilon naught. Gauss law for magnetization. integral magnetic field through an area is zero. And you could, in simple words, say there are no magnetic monopoles. The Faraday's law integral E ds, surface integral around a certain surface, is minus the phi magnetic flux lines by dt. And last but not least, the Ampere-Maxwell law. Integral B ds is mu naught epsilon naught electric flux lines by dt plus mu naught and I enclosed. So these are the four Maxwell equations. I would like to elaborate more now on the Faraday's law and the Ampere law. So, integral E ds is minus d phi b by dt. Here again, all the four Maxwell equations. So let's further look into the Faraday's law. So, what does that actually mean? We have a surface integral over an area, an electric field, and we have a change in magnetic flux lines. So let me try to make a drawing here, a sketch of that. Here our x-axis, and here our electric field. Let's define a certain area here. The length here should be dx on that side. So the strength here on that side is directly E. After a certain while, a certain area, certain distance, we have that length here, and this is now E plus dE on that side. There's a magnetic flux passing through that surface, and that's B field, or d phi. So the magnetic flux is phi B, and this is the B field times H times dx. So in simple words, this is the B field times the area of that surface. This is the magnetic flux. So what we want to know in the end is dB by dt, d phi b by dt. And this is now, oops, let me get back up. Sorry for that. Sorry for that interruption. d5b by dt is now h dx, the area, times db by dt. So this is the B field and the flux through that area. What is the, this is our first ingredient here. Now the second ingredient, what is actually that surface integral E ds? And this is straightforward. This is directly the line here around our surface. Actually, the mathematical sense is counterclockwise, So we go down here, that's E times H, and on the other side up, E plus dE times H. The upper and lower part are equal, the x is equal, so that cancels out. So we get in the end E plus dE times H minus, and now the other side here down, down here, this is E times H. And what we get in the end is H times dE. So now we have two equations, one and two. And let's plug that in into our Faraday law given here. And we get H times dE is H times dx times dB divided by dt. Great news. The H cancels out. I forgot the minus sign here. And we get in the end dE by dx is minus dB by dt. The minus sign, just to clarify, came from the starting equation from the Faraday's law. So this is our first important identity. We can now actually do the same thing for the Maxwell's law. The Maxwell law was integral B ds is mu naught epsilon naught d phi E flux lines of the electric field divided by dt. So here we can actually do the same logic, same picture. So if this is the direction of our electric field and perpendicular to that the magnetic field B, we can define a similar surface. Distance here is the x, and the length here is h. And what we now do is we have a flux phi of the electric field through that surface. Here we calculate the area. Phi e is actually e field times the area, and this is e times h times dx. And second part, line integral around that surface, once again counterclockwise. Minus b plus db, this is the line here, times h, plus b times h, that's the line on the other side. The upper and lower part are identical, dx is identical, it's parallel, so these two sections cancel out. And here, if we do that calculation, we get minus h times dB. Once again, we put both in direct relation to each other, as given here by the Maxwell law. And by doing so, we get minus h times dB is the flux. We have these prefactors mu naught epsilon naught, and now this term d phi by dE, and we have calculated that this is actually dE by dt times the area, and this is h where's the pen? Sorry for that. Fighting as well. This is h times dx. Please forgive me, I'm also fighting with these new technologies. And promise you, I'll become better and better. So the h here cancels out, and we get in the very end minus dB by dx is equal epsilon naught mu naught times dE by dt. This is our equation number 2. So we have now rewritten the Maxwell's law and the Faraday law here, number 1, Maxwell law number 2, in a different format. So I would like to stop that part of the lecture, second part, and will soon come to the third part.